choose who comes to our church. We don't pick and choose. But God, bring them in. Those who you've brought back to life. And those who you've mended. Because God, you're putting us to be responsible for that. What does that mean? I'm not just talking about his passion. I'm talking about us as a congregation. What does it mean to be responsible for someone? You know, sometimes it's easy to live in our own little world. We're busy. We have things going on. We have our own problems to deal with. Don't want to get dirty. Don't want to get messy with someone else's. But you know, Daniel, he needs you. But God has required of us to get messy. He's not only required, but he's given us the tools. He's given us what we need. And one day he's coming back and we'll get out of this all. But he'll repent. The Bible says, and be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as Christ, God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. And the Lord added daily to the church such as should be saved. Before the Good Samaritan left, he took out 2 pence, the Bible says. And he gives to the innkeeper. And he said, take care of him. Whatsoever he spend more, when I return, I will repay you. Now God's given us gifts, whether it's the knowledge of his word, power and spirit, jobs that we have resources to help others. God has given. And so there's a responsibility to take care of one another. In 2 Corinthians 5:18, the Word of God says, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us, listen, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation. And some having compassion, making a difference. And others saved with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Jesus said, whatever you spend more, Brother Eli, when I return, I will repay you. This is very interesting in itself. Because, Brother Justin, a pence was a day's wages. So he gave 2 pence. So he said, Brother Doug, here's a pence for one day. Here's a pence for another day. Sister Stacy, we may think, wow, 2 days, how long? Well, let me think about something for a moment. Christ has been gone almost, over 2,000 years. But the Word of God says that a day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. So he's given us 2 pence. He's given us. So I know we're living on extra time right now. But he said this for the devil. He said, whatever you spend over what I gave you, when I return, I will repay you. Tonight I just want to say this. That the Good Samaritan promised he will return. And he will repay for our labor. Tonight, let's labor. Because he's going to pay back. And I go away to prepare a place for you. I will come again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there ye may be also. He's the Good Samaritan. We're the innkeeper. Let's keep the inn well tonight. Does anyone have any thoughts, anything they'd like to say this evening regarding the Good Samaritan? No, no, that I there's more that could be said, and I took it away that I wanted to share. Because I'm burdened just to see growth in our church, to see people saved. Even if it means getting messy, it's all right. Because God's given us our resources. Let's utilize them. And if it costs more, it's all right. Because when He comes, He'll repay us.
My mind actually goes back to before the account. I never noticed it before, but if you look at the lawyer, he was ready to make a defense of his lifestyle. He was ready to take one God Almighty, the Messiah. And when you look down a little bit farther, because he almost has an argumentative attitude.
Sure does.
And when you look at it, after he poses the question, it states that he goes on to say, to justify his actions. And when you look at it, that's the majority of the church world today. We're living a religious lifestyle, but if they're sin or anything that they're not supposed to be doing, they're ready to justify.
Absolutely.
And I think he was, in today's society, it'd be almost like, well, define saved. You ask me if I'm saved, define saved, and then you say something. Well, what do you mean by that? And it seems ready to go back and forth, present an argument of case, but then Jesus breaks into the account, or the parable of the rich young ruler. And I think there, in my mind's eye, comes the verse of be ready to give every man an answer, the reason of hope that lies within you. And within this, we see one individual that's ready to defend his lifestyle, but yet we also see at work the power of the Holy Ghost through the parable itself, and how you see the complete demeanor of the lawyer change from one where he's ready to defend his actions and go gung-ho and I'm living in the right, to one where he realizes his need before God and that not everything's all right. And we just see the transition there, how even we need to be careful how we answer people when they ask this question, or even when we go evangelize and people talk about Christ, that one way we might present to somebody else might not work for somebody else. And just present it, not only just our presentation, but presenting it and allowing the Holy Ghost to guide us and with our words here, that way He may take it to work. Because what might be all right for one individual might raise a defense on the other, and they just might completely shun it. And I just thought that was
I agree with you. I think, you know, he was tempting Jesus. The Word of God was specific in saying that. And doesn't most people who are religious, they have a comeback immediately, their escape, for why they're living and doing what they want. But when we really look at the Word of God, we can't get away from it. I talk to a lot of people about religious things all the time just because of the nature of my profession, but my life as well. A lot of people have a lot of ideas, but they sure aren't based in the Bible. Well, I think God will show me from the Word of God. It's not what you think or I think, it's what God's Word says. Because without the Spirit of God and salvation, we're living life half dead. That part of us isn't alive. We've got to realize about the people. Their perception of God is so far off because the Spirit of God has not quickened them and brought them to life.
Very interesting that when he gives the parable, he talks about, you know, you have a lawyer who's questioning, but in the parable he uses a priest and a Levite who knows the law, and who should be the epitome of the law or whatever, and they're not doing the right thing. Kind of saying, pointing out that, you know, you might think that you're religious, you have that head knowledge, but again, the heart knowledge.
Experience And I think he was even speaking volumes of things that they would yet see about the blood of Jesus Christ, about the Holy Ghost being poured out. And Jesus was speaking deeper than what they even realized. And we have the privilege of that today. How much more is there a responsibility on us because we have that privilege? It's good. Someone else.
Share, you have good stuff all the time. Yeah, share. Mercy. Wow. I do want to be merciful. And we should. Because we love God and that's what He's done for us. Someone else.
That's why the Father takes me to the neighbor. Don't they food my neighbor? If any plant around the garden.
Amen. Let's stand this evening if you would. Appreciate you being here. Good to have Becky with us tonight. Amen. Let's just keep praying one for another. Get folks feeling better. I just want to see the Lord grow us. Amen. But that was just a prayer, if you would.
Father, so thank you, Lord, for our time in church tonight, Lord. As we study your word, Lord God, just pray, Lord, that you fill us with wisdom, Lord, and understanding. Lord, we pray also those kind of mercy that we talk about. Lord, we just pray, Lord, that we just please you in everything we do and say. Lord, we just look at those opportunities in ministry, Lord. And Lord, just give us the words to say and the right spirit to say. And all you're going to do, and just start our church, Lord, such a revival, Lord God, such a